Thank you to the Western Vascular Society membership and others for the privilege of your time today. I have much to be thankful for. Upon reflecting about those who have influenced me throughout my career, I must start right here at the top with my father, the late Ronald W. Starnes. He was a former Methodist minister and college professor who taught me the concepts of discipline and respect for human beings. He, along with my mother, Martha, were very devoted parents, and I owe them everything regarding any successes I may have had throughout my career. Unfortunately, they both died young at age 69 due to cancer. Interestingly, they died on the same exact day, spaced 2 years apart. My mother was an elementary school teacher for over 40 years and worked with this woman, Marge Lenihan. She and her husband Dick would come to our home for dinners on multiple occasions. Why is this important? Well, Dick was a vascular surgeon and took specific interest in me and my interest in becoming a surgeon. In high school, I was profoundly influenced by these three amazing women. Linda Malatesta was my math teacher, Elaine Scott, my guidance counselor, and Kathy Nell, who I had a crazy crush on, was my chemistry and science teacher. I knew in high school that I wanted to pursue medicine, and specifically surgery, and they helped me create a pathway to get there. For those of you who doubt my sincerity in saying I was interested in becoming a surgeon at such a young age, this is the 1984 yearbook entry as a high school senior at age 17. Future plans: college, medical school, peripheral vascular surgery. The only reason I even knew about peripheral vascular surgery was because of Dick Lenihan. Who were my idols growing up, aside from my parents? My father always talked about what a strong man Martin Luther King was, and he certainly became one of my idols. I think that Ron shared a passion for the Christian ministry with Dr. King in the southern United States. Charles Bronson, the macho actor who looked a lot like my dad, in fact, people mistook Ron for him on occasion. Arnold Palmer, the greatest golfer ever, in my opinion. Clint Eastwood. Sky Dog Dwayne Allman, the absolute best slide guitar player who ever lived and accomplished so much before he died in a Harley-Davidson motorcycle crash at age 24. Evel Knievel. And, of course, Hawkeye. Benjamin Franklin Pierce from the popular series MASH. The one thing common to all of these people is that they were fearless. In medical school, these two men greatly influenced me. Dick Schmidt was my anatomy professor, and surgeon Herb Cohn had a profound influence on multiple generations of surgeons at Jefferson Medical College in Philadelphia. There are so many friends to mention, but here are several notables. Nitin Singh, my great friend and colleague who I work out with just about every single day. Scott Steele, the ultimate motivator. Chuck and Donna Anderson. Zach Arthurs, Dan Clare, and Neil Hadro, who was my best man at our wedding. Frank Criado, Joe Caselli, and Germano Melisano. The late John Anderson, the father of Fenestrated Evar. And of course, Roy Greenberg, who I developed a very strong relationship with at the turn of the century. Tom Forbes, David Hartley, and Brendan Stanley, pictured here in Perth, Australia in 2009. Dr. Ben Pierce, the other Hawkeye. Peter and Vicky Schneider. George Lavinson, Vietnam War veteran and friend. John Eight, who I trained with at the Cleveland Clinic. Billy Tatum and Wendy Hamar, my research nurse and coordinator. Brenda Klein, my current research nurse coordinator and partner for 14 years at Harborview. Dorothy Abel from the FDA. Carlos Pellegrini and Juan Perotti, pictured here at my home on Mercer Island. The great Frank Veith, pictured here sitting on my Harley in my garage and at his meeting in New York. What about the surgeons who influenced me and taught me the trade, aside from those already mentioned? Ken Azaro and David Jakes, my general surgery program director. Dave Jakes and my wife Margie pinned my major oak leaves on here in the Eisenhower suite at Walter Reed in 1998. Craig Shriver, Norm Rich, Mary Maniscalco, and Brigadier General John Hutton, who was President Reagan's private physician as a vascular surgeon. My vascular surgery mentors at Walter Reed, Jim Goff, Sean O'Donnell, and Dave Gillespie. Ralph Whalen, Andy Seward, and John Piggott at the Jobst Vascular Institute in Toledo. Chris Zarens and Bruce Gewirtz, two of the most selfless vascular surgeons I know. Steve Wartyla and Manny Mehta, my Albany influence. Steve learned to do retroperitoneal aortic aneurysm repairs from Diraj Shah, and then he taught me exactly how to do them at Walter Reed. The Critical Issues America Organizing Committee, Frank Veith, Mark Farber, Gustavo Oderich, Louis Sanchez, and Matt Eagleton. This meeting has become the finest aortic meeting in America. And of course, the many surgeons and mentors at the University of Washington who have and continue to influence me today. Carlos Pellegrini, Doug Wood, Ron Mayer, and the late Alec Clues. And of course, all of my many, many colleagues at the University of Washington. We have developed a West Coast powerhouse over the past decade. I am so thankful to all of my teammates in the Division of Vascular Surgery for being so hardworking and so professional. For anyone else who I may not have acknowledged, please forgive me. Moving to my family, my brother Lincoln and I share so many passions together, like playing guitars and riding Harleys in the desert. The joys of my life, my daughters Kara and Jessica, who have spent their entire lives growing up in the Pacific Northwest. Of course, my beautiful wife and best friend, Margie. She and I together have truly been blessed with our health and our love for one another as a family. As many of you know, I have had the opportunity to travel around the world to exchange ideas and share clinical and life experiences. I feel very fortunate and humbled by those opportunities. Robert Pirsig said, "You look at where you are and where you're going, and it never makes sense. But then you look back at where you've been, and a pattern seems to emerge." And that leads me to the title of my address to you today: Zen and the Art of Bandsaw Maintenance, an Inquiry into Values. This is a wellness talk in the setting of our current challenging times. Of course, for those of you old enough to remember this book of nearly the same title that was written in the early 70s, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, this is a personal story, a story about resilience, loyalty, patience, hard work, respect, and love. It is a deep exploration into why I am standing here in front of you today. How did I get here? What was the pathway? For those of you not familiar with the terminology, I will define bandsaw for you as a power saw with a long, sharp blade consisting of a continuous band of toothed metal stretched between two or more wheels to cut material. The bandsaw that I will be referring to has been in my family as long as I can remember and was built in 1939. Depicted here is a nomogram showing the usage of the word bandsaw in the modern English literature. And there was a spike just before entering World War II. I'm now going to show you a short video clip from a series called If Walls Could Talk, which features my father in his woodshop when he was alive, and everyone will catch a quick glimpse of the bandsaw in the foreground.
The restoration of the Starnes 1700s house suited Ron. He's a furniture maker, specializing in 18th century reproductions, and his homework seems to speak to him.
The current journey began in the middle of the first wave of the pandemic on May 25th, 2020. Little did I know that my daughter would give me the key to unlock this beautiful story that I am about to tell you. That day, she wanted to make a wall holder for her guitar. I was supervising her on the bandsaw when the blade abruptly snapped in half. It was an old blade and I didn't have a replacement, so her project was now on hold. I went into my office and ordered a 113-inch quarter-inch bandsaw blade for $30 on Amazon. I then began to look inside the machine to see what I needed to do to realign the blade. I first started by removing each wheel and assessing the tires on each of them. These tires were clearly old and made of rubber and needed to be cut off with a knife. The rubber was clearly etched by years of use, and it was unclear to me when the last time these tires had been replaced. I hadn't really done any maintenance on this machine since my father died in 2002. As I stood and stared carefully at this tire, I thought of all the beautiful furniture that was made through the years using this bandsaw. In a way, it brought me closer to my father. Underneath these tires were layers and layers of caked-up glue that required hours of scrubbing and wire brushing and grinding to remove. After some time and effort, a nice, smooth, clean surface was detected underneath. This was extremely satisfying to me, which brings me to my first quote on values. The test of the machine is the satisfaction it gives you. There isn't any other test. If the machine produces tranquility, it's right. If it disturbs you, it's wrong until either the machine or your mind is changed. My bandsaw was built by a company called Walker Turner, and the serial number gave clues as to when and where it was manufactured. I wanted to dig into the history of this machine a little further. I went on my laptop and just began to scratch the surface. In the late 1920s, Ernest T. Walker and William Brewer Turner founded their company, which produced machines for home and light industrial use. My 16-inch bandsaw was built in 1939 in New Plains, New Jersey. Notice the belt guard, which seemed foreign to me, as I never knew our machine to have a belt guard as long as I lived. This fact comes into play a little bit later. In 1941, this bandsaw was listed as 460 pounds and list price was just over $100. That's just a little bit over $2,000 in today's money value. Which leads me to my second quote. We're in such a hurry most of the time, we never get much chance to talk or take time to reflect. The result is a kind of endless day-to-day shallowness, a monotony that leaves a person wondering years later where all the time went and sorry that it is all gone. Ronald graduated high school in 1951. This was his first woodshop around 1960 in Dagsboro, Delaware, when he purchased our bandsaw. He was featured here in a local magazine in 1982, and you can see the bandsaw in the background. Again, it had no belt guard, as you can see in the distance. I had grown up all my young life in a woodshop. My first truly aspirational piece was in 1995 when I was a general surgery resident at Walter Reed. I had been studying so hard to be a doctor, I hadn't taken the time to spend in the shop working with wood. It was so relaxing, and I found that the hours would fly by as I focused my energies on working the wood and feeling the course of the wood grain and how the grain direction influenced every chisel cut. Besides that, I got to spend time with one of my heroes. This is the result of that first real attempt. This Chippendale reproduction stool with the classic shells and ball and claw feet still sits in our foyer to this day. 3 years later, in 1998, I was chief resident at Walter Reed. I knew that Dave Jakes was retiring from the Army and that our resident class would be his last class as program director while in the Army. I wanted to take on a project to build him a chair and make it memorable for him. Most of you who know woodworking know that chairs are the absolute hardest pieces to make. There are so many complex angles and load points. This time, I again chose the Chippendale style, as it was my favorite. And here is the result. The year 2001 turned out to be a very difficult year for us. Ronald had been diagnosed with esophageal cancer and was undergoing chemotherapy. You can see his infusion port right here, and also the reason he had esophageal cancer with his affection for cigars. Margie and I had just returned from Germany, and I had started my vascular surgery fellowship. To spend more time with my dad in the last year of his life, I would go home every other weekend and began making an entire set of 8 Chippendale dining room chairs. We also added a new addition to the family, my oldest daughter, Kara. In that year, the shop was a place to laugh and tell stories, and all the while, the bandsaw sat quietly in the background as a part of it all. That year was also a time to say goodbye. Here is the result of that year's efforts. Those of you who have been to my home have sat with me in these very chairs at our dinner table. Which leads me to my next value. Anxiety, the next gumption trap, is sort of the opposite of ego. When you're anxious, you're so sure you'll do everything wrong, you're afraid to do anything at all. Often this, rather than laziness, is the real reason you find it hard to get started. I had no anxiety about taking on those complex projects, as I knew it would be a pathway to more confidence in the woodshop. My father and mother passed, and life went on. Margie and I moved our small family to the West Coast, and I attended my first Western Vascular meeting in 2002. I was so impressed by the membership and the welcoming I received from every one of the members. This is me and Kara right after returning from a combat tour in Iraq at the Western Vascular meeting in Kona in 2003. Working in the wood shop became painful for me. All of the tools that surrounded me were my father's. It only brought back the raw memories of my father and I working together, and I missed him sorely. My attention turned to other extracurricular activities. In 2008, I climbed Mount Rainier for the first time. It was a new and refreshing experience. I spent hours in my garage packing and repacking my gear in front of the bandsaw, which patiently and calmly waited for my return. Which leads us to 2 more quotes. The only Zen you can find on the tops of mountains is the Zen you bring up there. Is it hard? Not if you have the right attitudes. It's having the right attitudes that's hard. I occasionally made it out in my shop to do things that were needed, like these custom shelves that I built with my youngest daughter, Jessica. By 2015, I had reconnected with my love for motorcycles. Margie had finally had enough with me talking about buying a Harley, so on Christmas of that year, she did the impossible. She went out and bought me one. I've showed this picture before with Frank Veith, but if you look closely, you can see the bandsaw in the background. In 2018, I upgraded to a Road Glide Special so that Margie could ride with me. Riding was now a permanent fixture of my life. In a car, you're always in a compartment, and because you're used to it, you don't realize that through that car window, everything you see is just more TV or smart device. You're a passive observer, and it is all moving by you boringly in a frame. On a cycle, the frame is gone. You're completely in contact with it all. You're in the scene, not just watching it anymore, and the sense of presence is overwhelming. Now, ladies and gentlemen, why have I been sharing all of this information about bandsaws and values? I'm going to tell you a secret about me. The reason I stand here before you today is the bandsaw. I'm going to briefly rewind to the year 1977. What was going on in 1977? Let me remind you. Apple Computers was incorporated. The maiden flight of Space Shuttle Enterprise occurred. Star Wars was released. Elvis Presley performed his last ever concert on June 26th and was dead 2 months later. Ronnie Van Zant and Steve Gaines from Lynyrd Skynyrd died in a plane crash. And John Travolta starred in Saturday Night Fever. But what also happened that year was the 34th president of the Western Vassar Society started his journey in a woodshop. It was Sunday, April 10th, 1977. I remember it vividly, as my dad always watched the Masters golf tournament. He loved Arnold Palmer and only wanted to see Jack Nicklaus lose. Jack was charging on Sunday, but Tom Watson fended him off on the back nine to win his first green jacket. That day, I asked my father if I could use the bandsaw to make a gift for my mother, whose birthday was a month away. He said, "Sure, just don't cut yourself." At 10 years of age, I went out into the shop and began my project. I was trying to even up two pieces of wood end to end to make the pieces the same length, and my left hand wandered into the circulating blade. It went straight to the bone of my middle finger. Being that it happened so fast, I didn't feel any pain, but there was blood everywhere. I turned the bandsaw off, carefully wiped the blood off the machine and the floor, and tried to figure out how in the world I was going to keep this from my dad. It was impossible. I had to tell him. I walked into our family living room where my brothers and father were watching the tournament, and I told Dad the news. He looked down, very concerned at first, but after seeing the wound, smiled broadly and said, "Congratulations, son." I was puzzled and looked at him confused. He replied, "You are now a full-fledged cabinet maker. You can't be a full-fledged cabinet maker until you cut yourself on one of those machines." I felt myself stand a little taller in front of my two older brothers, but it was time to go to the emergency room. The whole experience for me was impactful. No one can keep a 10-year-old boy from looking at what you're doing to sew up a wound. I watched as the doctor painted brown betadine on the wound and then injected lidocaine. It was magic. The sterile gloves, the bright lights, the needles, the sterile field, the surgical masks, the precision. I was hooked. I want to do that. I want to operate on people and fix them when they're broken. I have carried this scar all my life, and it reminds me of why I'm here. Peace of mind produces right values. Right values produce right thoughts. Right thoughts produce right actions. And right actions produce work, which will be a material reflection for others to see of the serenity at the center of it all. Here is the bandsaw before I started this journey. It was rusted and corroded and neglected for many years. Here it is, completely disassembled on my garage floor. And here it is today. I decided to try and find a belt guard to be complete. I found a place in Manchester, Connecticut that had a belt guard for a 1939 Walker Turner bandsaw. It was cast iron and required a mounting bracket. The entire guard plus shipping was over $600, but it was essential. I tracked the package from Manchester, Connecticut to Northampton, Pennsylvania, to Elmore, Ohio, and Omaha, Nebraska, from there to Wamsutter, Wyoming, up to Troutdale, Oregon, and finally, Redmond, Washington. My guard had traversed the entire United States, like I did with my little family in 2002. The guard arrived safely, but there was only one problem. The mounting bracket didn't fit. This required grinding and filing down the edges of the mounting bracket to get it to fit just right. Here is the mounting bracket and belt guard installed. And here she is, like brand new, going strong at 81 years of age. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is the gavel box I made using the bandsaw, forever linking it to our society's history. I have one last quote for you. The real bandsaw you're working on is a bandsaw called yourself. I'll finish with a pivot to a patient story, and this is my last slide. Elaine was born in the same year that my bandsaw was manufactured, 1939. This 81-year-old woman presented to me with a large juxtarenal aortic aneurysm. I was able to maintain Elaine's life by repairing her aneurysm in the setting of my IDE clinical trial using fenestrated endografting. Her procedure took 75 minutes to complete with 17 minutes of fluoro time. She went home the day after surgery. Elaine owes her life to a bandsaw of the same vintage as herself. Friends, I absolutely love the profession that I chose, and it seems to me that everything in this universe is connected. We just need to find the connections and somehow embrace and define them. Connection is what gives purpose and meaning to our lives. After all, it's why we're here. It has been the highlight of my career to have served as your 34th president of the Western Vascular Society. Thank you.
Yeah! me sometimes and you don't. But leave your mind alone, just get high. Subway train. Don't forget the poor.